Welcome to Keith Knight, Don't Tread on Anyone in the Libertarian Institute, part two of my interview with Mr. Molyneux. Check out his work at freedomain.com. Also, if you subscribe to him on Odyssey, you could find his complete collection of videos going back more than a decade. That is where I watch him. Also available on podcast hosting sites as well. Check the link in the description below. Mr. Molyneux, what differentiates a good philosopher from a bad philosopher?
Yes, great question. Good? Everyone else? No. So the good philosopher, bad philosopher, it's something I did a whole, it's a 22-part history of philosopher series for subscribers on the show. And one of the things, which seems like a fairly trivial insight in hindsight, but was kind of mind-blowing to me at the time, is that there is no history of philosophers objectively. In other words, there wasn't just this meritocracy of who was really good and who wasn't really good, and they just chose the very best, like everybody runs a race and whoever gets across the finish line. It's like philosophers who were allowed to speak and philosophers who are allowed to be taught and philosophers who, to some degree or another, serve the powers that be. So one of the reasons I think that we know so much about Socrates is that Socrates justified the power of the state by saying, hey, if the city decides to kill me, well, that's fine, because the city, I relied on the laws to survive, I relied on the laws to get my food and my protection, and the city has protected me from invasion, and so if the government decides to kill me, well, I owe my government the life, and therefore my life is for the governments to do as it pleases, which I actually think was a complete curse. I have a whole series of this from like 15 years ago. This is a curse on humanity, because Socrates says that most men are unwise, most men are fools, and people were voting for him. And so he knew that the vote was not an act of wisdom, but an act of prejudice and sophistry, which he directly accused Meletus of inciting. So he said, as his curse, kill me, fine, I'll just tell you to obey the state, and everything's going to go great for you going forward. So Socrates is allowed because of that. So a good philosopher in general has to start with a completely blank slate and no assumptions whatsoever. You have to return to a state almost of infancy and say, okay, I have a whole bunch of assumptions based upon my empirical experience. I have been told a whole bunch of moral lessons by people who are probably corrupt to the core. So what happens if I completely wipe blank my preconceptions and start building from reason and evidence and first principles, accepting every step and having to validate every step? So the general pattern is a sort of four-part series of dominoes in good philosophy is you start with metaphysics. Metaphysics is what is real. What is real, what is true, what is objective. What exists, what doesn't exist, how do I, and that's sort of what is. And then you have to go to epistemology, which is a fancy word for the theory of knowledge. So if I know what is real, then how do I know that? And how do I differentiate what is real from the unreal, what is true from the false? From there, you have to go to ethics, because the whole point of philosophy is ethics. There is philosophy of science, there's philosophy of mathematics, there's philosophy of religion, but the only thing that differentiates philosophy from all the other disciplines is morality. So if you're not doing morality, you're not doing philosophy. And then the big challenge is you have to overcome what Hume called the is-ought distinction, which is to say, and Andrew Wilson was talking about this in a recent podcast, you can't get an ought from an is. You can't get a should from a fact. You know, if a guy pushes a woman off a cliff, she falls to her death. Okay, that's a physical fact. That's a fact of physics and biology. Why should you or should you not do these things? And from there, in the current system that we have, you then have to go to politics. Politics is a study of the morally legitimated institutional use of coercion or violence in society. Now, of course, as a voluntarist or an anarchist, it is my goal in probably about half a millennia to have a society which is free of institutionalized coercion that is justified by the general population out of fear of a lack of safety. But that's not where we are, so you kind of have to deal with politics to some degree or another. So good philosophers start with the assumption of nothing, and this comes straight out of René Descartes' Meditations, which is okay, what if I am in fact just a brain in a tank being wired up by a demon to, like, Matrix style, right? What if everything is just a fantasy and nothing is real? Well, that's an important question. I mean, every night we go to sleep and have these most amazing, vivid dreams. I won't even tell you the costume that you were wearing in my dream last night, because it would probably get you banned from the planet as a whole. But although the elephant head does look good on you. But so every night we have these wild, vivid dreams. We wake up and we know for sure that they were dreams and we're now awake. And the good philosopher says, well, how do we know that? Assume nothing, right? The good physicist says, well, the world does look flat, as we talked about last time, and everything looks like it. The stars look like they're rotating around us like some inverse halogen colander or something. But what if that's not true? What if everything I perceive is incorrect? And that way you can build a certain edifice of knowledge. And many philosophers have tried this to varying degrees of success. The most notable being, I would say, René Descartes and Immanuel Kant just said, okay, what if nothing is true and I have to build everything up from the ground up? And that's really been my process. I think it was about 17 or so years ago, I did a 17-part introduction to philosophy series where I said, you know, with a whiteboard and, you know, my primitive 240p camera, and I said, what if we don't know anything? What if I don't know if I exist or you exist or the sense data is real or anything? How do we go from there to abstract universal moral philosophy? And it's a big challenge. So the philosophers that I like the most, who respect the most, are the ones who absolutely, like, you have to grit your teeth. It's like when I used to do long distance running when I was in my teens and my 20s. Like, when you start, you feel like you're going to die after the first 10 minutes. And then after you break through that, you can run, you know, I ran 20 miles once, and you can just keep going. And you just have to grit your teeth and say, I'm not going to stop, you know, just keep swimming, just going to keep going and not divert. Now, to me, the best philosophers are the ones who take that approach. I know nothing. I'm going to build these principles from the ground up. And it doesn't matter to me where they lead. I am not invested in the outcome. I am only invested in the process. So philosophers like Ayn Rand started with metaphysics and epistemology. There's a whole great book called Introduction to Objectivist Epistemology. And then she went through to ethics, which I think she failed at. And then she went through to politics, which she also failed at, because she still justified the existence of institutionalized coercion such as statism. But staying on that ride is really tough. And then the last thing, not only, but also, you also get this free ShamWow cloth. But not only that, after you go through that process, you then have the challenge of saying, okay, I've gone through metaphysics, epistemology, ethics, politics. I have a robust moral system. Now, how does it get applied in people's actual lives? That is, to me, the biggest challenge of all. And I think one of the things that differentiates what I do from what other philosophers do is I've now had, over the last, I mean, close to 20 years now, I started in 2005, so yeah, it's almost 20 years. I've had thousands and thousands of conversations with people about how to take abstract moral principles and apply them to their actual daily practical lives. And so it's one thing to build this wonderful cathedral of thought, but people also have to come in and get some moral instructions and have their lives improved thereby. And so a lot of philosophers aim for abstractions and just keep going. They don't return to earth with these abstractions and give practical utility to people. It's like people who study, you know, theories of diet and so on, but never write any diet books that can actually help people. So I've done, you know, the theoretical work that I think is very important. And in terms of practical application, so for instance, the non-aggression principle is very, very simple to defend and universalize. And then the question is, once you've done that, what happens? Well, what happens with most people, this is particularly true in more liberty-minded circles, is they say, well, you know, the central banking is just counterfeiting. It's like, yes, it is. And what are you going to do about it, right? And the what are you going to do about it is the question. Of course, we don't want to go and, you know, use violence ourselves. So what do you do? Foreign aid is taking money from the poor people of rich countries and sending it to the rich people of poor countries, and it corrupts other countries and so on. And it's like, yes, that's true. And so what are you going to do? War is bad, yes. And so the yes and what do you do about it is the challenge. So again, I was like blank slating Because that's my sort of, every morning it's like, grit your teeth and blank your slate, right? And so I was blank slating and saying, okay, so once we accept that the non-aggression principle, thou shalt not initiate the use of force, once we accept that that's a valid moral principle, what are we going to do? Well, I could complain about things I have no control over, but that doesn't seem to be like a very good idea at all. I mean, it is like lecturing a graveyard on how to take care of their health. I mean, it's a little bit past the issue at hand, and you can't really affect the outcome because it's already in the past. So what I said was, okay, so violations of the non-aggression principle, what's the most widespread violation of the non-aggression principle that we can do the most about? What's the most widespread violation of the non-aggression principle that we can do the most about? Now, of course, I worked in a daycare as a kid, as a teenager for many years and so on, and saw various negative outcomes. Of course, I had some negative outcomes myself as a child and saw other people with negative outcomes due to violence within the home. It's like, ah, okay. So what is the most common violation of the non-aggression principle? Well, spanking. I mean, 75, 80, 90% really depends on the ethnicity of parents who are still hitting their children. So that is the biggest violation, the most widespread violation of the moral, of the non-aggression principle that we can do the most about. Yay! Philosopher has returned from the heavens with tablets of practical action. Sorry to put myself in rather illustrious and heavily bearded company. So the idea then that we would say, let's work on child abuse, let's work on violations of the non-aggression principle against children, and so on, that was to me the most practical outcome. And so I made the case in many, many different venues and forums and PowerPoints and speeches and debates and all of that. And I recently, of course, finished my magnum opus on this called Peaceful Parenting, which people can get at peacefulparenting.com. It's free. There's even an AI you can ask parenting questions that will give you some pretty fantastic answers. So I think good philosophers start with a blank slate, work their way to the most broad abstractions, and then bring them back to earth in practical and actionable manners so that you can become a moral person. Because if the purpose of morality is to rail at the toenails of the gods you can do nothing about, then it's simply an exercise in paralysis and futility. But if you can, like if you say, well, the purpose of moral philosophy is to end foreign aid, it's like, well, good luck with all of that, right? I mean, you can talk to people and you could, I guess, even run for office, but of course we can see what's going on right now. With people who run for office who aren't part of the elite, who actually want to change things, they tend to get some fairly pretty ear clippings from time to time. And so, but what you can do is you can talk within your family and friendships and social circle about not violating the non-aggression principle with regards to helpless and dependent children. That's something you can do. And that practical aspect is tricky, though. Because, you know, railing against the Federal Reserve and foreign aid and the national debt gives you a certain amount of chest-beating satisfaction, but it doesn't actually really do much to achieve good in society. But if you actually take on something like hitting children, then you can achieve some real good. But the problem is, of course, when you achieve real good, I can tell you this from some fairly vivid personal experience, Keith, when you actually achieve some good, you get that lovely little thing called blowback, you know, because, you know, if you're yelling about foreign aid and you don't shift where $1 goes, you don't really bother anyone. But the moment you actually start to change the disposition of good and evil in society, well, it's funny, you know, one of my favorite books when I was younger is The Hobbit. And The Hobbit is a fantastic book because most fairy tales end, oh, we've killed the dragon. Everything's fantastic. Yay, look at all this treasure. There's no more danger for Lake Town. And everyone's like dancing and singing. And that's usually the end of the movie. But the genius, one of the many aspects of genius of Tolkien is, well, after you kill the dragon, there's a war, there's Battle of the Five Armies. Everybody fights over the treasure. And so ending evil often creates a power vacuum, and that's a challenge. If you directly interfere with the intentions of evil people, they will attack you back. And because you're in the right and they're in the wrong, it'll usually be lies, slander, and reputational attack or physical violence. And so to do good means angering evil, and they're going to have something to say about what you do. And so I think the good philosopher gets people to enact virtue in their daily lives in measurable and objective ways. And of course, if we can do our part in ending child abuse, most of the other evils in society will fall as well.
How can we differentiate smart people from ignorant people?
Well, so IQ is obviously an imperfect measure, but it's the best we've got. And it's the one that is by far the most correlated with success in the world. And of course, if people can come up with an intelligence test that better predicts outcomes than IQ does, I would be the first to sort of champion it. So IQ is kind of the best thing that we've got for intelligence at the moment. Now, IQ, and I did like a series of interviews with people. It was, 17 world experts in the field of IQ to sort of help understand this, because I wanted to know how to be fair and how to be just, right? You want to know how to be fair and be just. So I don't want to blame people for things beyond their control, right? You don't want to blame people for being short or their eye color or things that are really beyond their control, because that would be unfair and unjust. That would be like blaming a kid for being lazy because he happened to be born into a poor family and, he just didn't have much money. Now, you can, if an adult doesn't have much money, maybe they're kind of lazy, but you wouldn't blame a kid for that, right? So I wanted to figure out what was under people's control and what wasn't. And so you want to, as a philosopher, your goal is to increase people's wisdom, because wisdom is somewhat of a choice. Now, in the research, seems to be fairly clear, IQ is about 80% genetic by your late teens. It even goes up somewhere from there, but that, you know, let's sort of take the baseline of 80%. Now, that still gives you 20% to work with. That's a lot, right? That's more than a standard deviation of intelligence, like 100 to 85 or 100 to 115, give or take, right? So to determine whether somebody is intelligent or not, there are a couple of tests that I use. And again, just because they're not intelligent doesn't mean they can't become wise. Although intelligence can help, although the argument is as well that intelligent people can talk themselves in and out of 20 different positions in a day, and I know I've certainly been in that camp as well. So there's a couple of things that I do. So when you make a generalized statement and somebody comes back with a specific exception, that generally is somebody who is not thinking. Just if somebody doesn't think, there's two reasons. Either they can't think because they're just not smart, or they can think, but they've chosen not to, which means they lack self-criticism. So that's one thing. And, you know, the typical example is women are generally shorter than men. It's like, well, I know a guy, his girlfriend's taller than he is. And it's like, I'm afraid the giant addition that you are making to the conversation may be visible only to you, or as the old saying, wisdom has constantly been chasing you, but you've always been slightly faster. So that's one example. Another example, of course, which is very common, is the response of an ad hominem or a personal attack to a moral statement. Now, this, I'm going to introduce this because nobody on the internet has ever seen this before. I'm one of those rare travelers who's seen this incredible resurrected dodo bird of the ad hominem. So if you say there's a general statement and somebody says, well, only an a-hole would say that, it's like, well, maybe, but that still doesn't deal with the facts of the issue. So when someone is triggered, intelligence gives you the option to intercept your lizard brain responses, right? So you have, depends on how you clock it, but generally you have about a quarter second to intercept an aggressive impulse and reason with it and so on. And for most people, whatever their mental reflexes are, it's some longer than a quarter of a second, because people just, they act out, they get aggressive, they get mad and so on, right? I mean, in a perverse way, I was proud of what was voted of mine the worst tweet in the history of Twitter. And in the modern parlance, being called the worst guy is, people retweet Stalin and Hitler, but no, my tweet was voted and fairly overwhelmingly as the worst tweet in the history of Twitter, which was a little surprising to me. It went something like, I can't believe this is 5 years ago, but I said, wow, Taylor Swift is turning 30. She's so young. She looks so young. I hope that she'll think about having kids, because by the time you're 30, like 90% of your eggs are dead as a woman. I hope she'll think about having kids. She looks like she'd be a fun mom. Now, that was actually very positive. I have nothing against Taylor Swift, well, except her politics and her radiating childlessness to the NPC crowd. Well, okay, maybe I have a couple of things against Taylor Swift and her fans. Wait, no, let's not get drawn down the Taylor Swift side quest. So people went completely nuts. It is a scientific fact that 90% of a woman's eggs are dead by the time she's 30. That doesn't mean she can't have kids. She's still got 5 years until it's geriatric pregnancy. But people went completely mental about that and were just, you know, nobody's going to have sex with you, incel. It's like, okay, I'm happily married for 22 years, but okay. What am I going to do? I'm going to have sex with everyone but you, incel. You know, like this kind of stuff, right? It's like, oh, really? Bitter, angry, dangerous, sociopathic women might be withholding sex from me? Whatever am I going to do to get through the day? So that's another example of people who are just triggered. People who don't express doubt. Certainty is, I used to call them the period people because I grew up in sort of a very poor welfare, fairly crappy, trashy neighborhood. And it was full of people who were like, you know, it's just like this, period, you know, and the period was like, blah, 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 period, you know, end of discussion. It's like, really? For me, the only end of discussion is probably about 15 to 20 minutes after I'm dead. I'm sure I'll have some, or like, hey, you know how your fingernails grow after you die and your hair? Well, I will continue to have debates and discussions. There'll be some scratching on the coffin roof. I'll continue going on for a little while. So for me, the end of discussion is the end of life. But for these people, it's like, boom, period, end of discussion. And it's like, okay, so I kind of move on from that as a whole. People who don't expose themselves to contradictory opinions, you know, the echo chamber stuff. And this is why, like, people on the left have, you know, good and bad points. But in general, they tend to be less robust because they're exposed to far more echo chambers. Anybody who's not on the left is just, you're just swimming against the current. And you just get stronger. Like, you just get stronger swimming against the current. So, of course, I'm a, you know, very much a free market guy and a reason and evidence guy and objectivity guy. And so, I mean, in high school, it was fairly lefty in England and Canada and other places, and in university and outright Marxist and so on. And I was in the theater world. I went to the National Theater School. I wrote and directed plays. And I mean, in Canada, the theater world is, it makes Lenin look like Ayn Rand. So, because, you know, dependent on government money and NPCs that kind of way. And they're not interested in exploring the human condition, which is what good artists should do. They're just interested in promoting division, hatred, and resentment. So it is a monster. So, you know, sailing against the currents, you just end up kind of robust. So when you hear people repeat NPC talking points, and they just don't have any idea that there's another perspective or opinion, then they're just not intelligent, because to be intelligent is to be skeptical, right? Because if you haven't noticed, if you haven't noticed that the world is full of pathological liars in power, I don't even know what to tell you. You know, that is the old thing, like one fish turns to the other and says, hey, water's a little chilly today. It's like, water? What water? I just float, right? So if people haven't noticed that there are pathological liars in power and that there's a massive incentive for people in power to lie to them, and therefore they should have skepticism. You know, what's the old thing about, it's pretty easy for a woman to be attractive to man, just put on a sundress and say you don't trust the government. I mean, you're set, right? So anybody who hasn't noticed that, like, I really don't know. Hey, mainstream media doesn't always tell the truth. They're not super objective. And if you haven't noticed that, I honestly wouldn't even know. It's like there's a cruel meme about the boomers where they say, you know, when you're arguing with a boomer, and I can say this because I missed by 1 year. 1 year. I know I may look like the crypt keeper to your younger audience, but I missed by 1 year. I'm still pre-boomer by 1 year. But you know, when you're arguing with the boomer, you're arguing with the television. The television can't hear you and it doesn't care. And so people who don't have inputs and people who get aggressive when contradicted or when counter-information comes up, people who cite specific exemptions to general rules as some intellectual work of achievement and so on. And also, honestly, I view people who don't read fiction as a problem, because one of the things that's highly correlated with the development of empathy is the reading of fiction. Because fiction is your chance to try on another person's life for size, especially first-person fiction. I wrote a novel not too long ago where I switched between first and third person in a way to kind of disorient. This is how the person looks from the outside, but this is what they're thinking on the inside. And people who don't read fiction generally don't have as much empathy. And this is not just my opinion. Studies have been done that the reading of fiction generally helps foster empathy because you're then curious about how other people think and feel. And a lot of debate has to do with empathy. And because the opposite of debate is violence, and violence is the opposite of empathy, right? So if you and I are debating, we're negotiating to try and find the truth to the mutual benefit, right? If if we're driving to Vegas and I'm going the wrong way and you tell me to go the right way, you haven't harmed me, you've helped me. The purpose is truth. So we empathize with each other with reasoning. The people who use ad hominems, and there's all these terrible stories online at the moment after the second, what seems like an assassination attempt against Trump. There's lots of people saying, I had this friend of like 10 years or 20 years. We were talking about the assassination, and my friend said, "I can't. It's a damn shame they didn't miss." And it's like, ooh, that's what's that? Knock knock. Trump to Harris. Knock knock. Who's there? Owen. Owen who? Owen two, right? So that level of, to me, just straight up sociopathy. I wish that somebody I disagree with politically got killed. Well, of course, that's most of human history. Most of human history is killing people who disagreed with you, whether it's hitting them on the head with a club or the jawbone of an ass, or it's putting them in concentration camps, or sending them to war. I mean, a lot of a lot of Republicans in the South. And so the wars wipe out the soldiers and so on. So you way to wipe out your political enemies. So empathy is that we are going to be happy to reason with each other because we know that the only alternative to reasoning with each other, the only alternative to reasoning with each other is outright violence. And that will destroy society as a whole. And so I look for people who are interested in fiction and not just, I have a prejudice more for 19th century fiction is sort of my favorite time because there was genuine examination of the human condition and, deep thoughts without the politics creeping in at all times and under all circumstances, no matter what. And so I look for people who are interested in fiction. Poetry as well is a way to enter somebody else's dream state and imagination to have a self and an other. So there's lots of cool things that I use to try and figure out who's worth really talking to. I've already zoomed in your bookshelf to look for fiction in the back to make sure we can talk. Sorry, go ahead.
You know what? Fiction is actually on this side. I promise it's here.
Left? Oh, no, it's left-wing fiction. Sorry, go ahead.
So my favorite thing to do is to really get a quick idea of where someone stands on a given topic and ask them to steel man the opposition. Mm. And if they can't do it without straw manning, when I specifically ask for a steel man, I know that I'm wasting time with a person. So thank you so much for giving me those to add to the ideas of how I can communicate to people and find out who's worth spending time with. One of my favorite contributions you have given the world is your ability to analyze propaganda. I had never seen this before. Mr. Molyneux goes line by line in certain articles and really walks you through the manipulative language that's used. So I want to go through a couple of my favorite examples. In April of 2014, the sitting president and graduate from Harvard University, Barack Obama, said, "It's not a myth, it's math," referring to the gender wage gap. Apparently, he actually believed this. So, women earn 77 cents on the dollar for every dollar a man makes. Therefore, there is a gender pay gap. This gap between the genders is proof of sexism. What, if anything, is wrong with that logic?
Right. I'm going to zoom out for just a second because there's a couple of threads I want to talk about with regards to propaganda. And apparently, this is just all about me. So I'll do that, and I think it'll make sense. So let me ask you, where are you in the birth order of your family?
I am the youngest. My brother is the oldest, my sister's older than I am, and I am the third child. We all share a father. My mother only has me.
Okay, got it. Now, what's the age gap? This will make sense. Just bear with me for a sec.
He is 37. She is 34. I'm 28.
Okay. So when you were a kid, a little kid, and of course, there's quite a substantial age gap. I'm a younger sibling as well. My brother's a couple of months older than me. So when you were a kid, it was hard to get resources relative to your siblings, right? So if they had the toy, if you had the toy, they could get it from you. If they had the toy, you couldn't get it from them. And so when you're a little kid, you have to complain when you don't get your fair share, right? So there's older people that the parents get whatever they want. The older siblings get whatever they want. They have the cool toys. They get to stay up later. They get more allowance. They get more privileges. They get more freedom. And there's a certain amount of resentment. And it's not unhealthy. It's how we've evolved. There's nothing wrong with it. But there's a certain amount of resentment that comes from being a younger sibling, and mothers have to be very sensitive to this and equalize things. And they have to equalize things sometimes using force, right? They have to literally, if the older kid snatches the toy from the younger kid, the mother has to take it, some to pry it out of the hands maybe, and give it back. And of course, we don't say to kids, well, there's a whole bunch of food there, and you've got a one-year-old, a five-year-old, and a 10-year-old. Well, you all just go and get as much food as you want, and we'll just let it be a meritocracy. It's like, no. You have to take food and make sure that the youngest kid gets it, and so on, right? So forced redistribution, resentment of people who are doing better than you, complaining and appealing to authority to get resources from the more competent and successful and give them to you is a childhood experience. So propaganda, you won't believe how I'm going to bring this in for a landing. Nobody knows what the heck I'm talking about. Trust me, or don't, but I will bring it in for a landing, right? So what is it that politicians are continually saying to people? The rich aren't paying their fair share. Corporations don't pay enough in taxes. You're being ripped off. And what they're doing is they're trying to appeal to a childhood mindset where things are unfair through no fault of your own. You're not getting enough. It's not your fault that you happen to be born last. And there are all of these older siblings who are getting more. And it's unfair, and you need to appeal to authority to take from people who are more successful and more competent. In your childhood, it would be your older siblings, and give to you. And without that, you just can't survive. So what they're doing, this is so common in propaganda, it's one of the reasons why leftism and classism and this kind of division stuff works, is they're trying to get you to regress to a state of childhood, which is envy, resentment, and helplessness. Right. I mean, this maybe I'm alone in this pettiness. I don't think I am, but I very clearly remember as a kid, my brother had the right to stay up 5 minutes later. I mean, this is sad. I'm not proud of this, but, you know, it's just the way that I was and I've dealt with it completely. But I remember sitting in my bed and I knew I was probably about, I don't know, 4 or 5 years old. And I knew that 5 minutes was me counting to 300, right? This is how sad it is. But you have to be this way as a younger sibling. You have to, because otherwise you don't get enough resources. And so, 5 minutes, is it? Fine. 1, 2, I won't do the whole 300 for you, but I would sit there and I'd have my covers off my toes to make sure I didn't miscount. And it would be like, it's been 5 minutes. It's bedtime. And like, this is how petty and right? Oh my gosh. It's now, as a kid, you have to guard your interests that way. You have to say, look, there are people doing better through no fault of my own. And no, you know, it bothered me that the older kids, you know, oh, you're just a little kid. It's like, oh, wow, you did the amazing moral task of having to drop out of mom's for JJ slightly earlier than I did. Wow. What a thing to be achieved, right? So as a kid, this resentment of people who are doing better and taking more, and the appeal to authority to make things equal is how younger siblings survive. Now, I've only done a cursory examination of this, and you, of course, would be an exception here, but a lot of people on the left are younger siblings. And when the government comes to you and says, Injustices are being done against you. Those with more power are taking more, and we're here to make it equal. Well, that, why is that such a common experience for people? We all go through childhood, right? We all go through childhood. And all younger siblings have to fight like heck to make sure we get our fair share. Through no fault of our own, we happen to be smaller and weaker and younger and so on, right? And so when the government comes along and says, there are people who are unjustly taking from you, and we're here to make it right. Well, that is, men are stealing from you, women, and we are here to make them give you back what they've taken from you. We're here to make sure you get your fair share, which through no fault of your own is being taken from you. Why is that so believable to everyone? Well, because it's an essential part of how siblings survive. And most people grow up with siblings, and there are a lot of younger siblings. So you see this all the time in election years, where it's like, the rich aren't paying their fair share. Well, why does that seem believable to people? Because one cursory look at the data is like, no. The rich aren't paying their fair share. They're paying way too much. You know, when the top, 5% of earners are paying 50% of the income tax, that's ridiculously unfair. But why is it that people are, like, there is a greedy part, which is like, ooh, I can resent people and get stuff for free. I get all of that. But why is it that it's so believable for people when the government comes along and says, and, this is from as relatively mild a case as the gender pay gap to something as completely egregious, which we talked about in the last conversation, which is, the communists coming along and saying, that factory was stolen from your ancestors. We're going to go kill the factory owners and give it back to you. Well, that's appealing to a parent in a sibling dynamic on massive, hyper-ideological steroids. But I think that when we have an incredibly common experience, like resentment of the successful and the appeal of authority to equalize, why is it? Because that's how most of us survive. You know, in human evolution, when people had no birth control and, the same sex drives as we have now, well, what happened? Well, you had, 5, 8, 10, 12 kids. And so the vast majority of us are younger siblings, not youngest, but younger siblings, right? The vast majority of us are younger siblings. And younger siblings, we have to appeal to authority, complain, be resentful, look for equalization, and be perfectly happy when force is used to get us resources. Because we don't survive. Otherwise, you think, of course, of limited food. There was limited food throughout most of our evolution. Things were touch and go for a lot of kids. And you really had to fight like hell. And you had to appeal to authority to take things away from the more powerful and give them to you. So to me, a lot of propaganda is having people, through the language of parenting, regress into a helpless, resentful, and dependent upon authority state of mind, to get people to regress to childhood. And it's very tempting, because that is the mindset, particularly for young people. There's this idea that people become more free market and conservative as they age. But that's because we get further away from childhood. Whereas when you're young, getting you to regress to a childhood state of mind is pretty easy. So when you go to women and you say, well, men are taking stuff from you and it's unequal and you're underpaid and so on, there's a certain amount of greed for the unearned, for sure. But there's a lot of girls who had older brothers who did who just took stuff from them and got more time, attention, who had more privileges because they were older. And there's just this resentment. And I think it's pretty easy to strip mine. The numbers, of course, are easy to debunk, right? I mean, we can just touch on them briefly here. Women with the same amount of education who've been in the workforce for the same amount of time as men actually earn more than men. Women take less high-paying degrees and careers. The student loan debt crisis is largely women taking economically unproductive degrees. If you look at the highest paid professions, like oil engineering, petroleum engineering is like the highest paid profession. There's almost no women. Computer science for a long time there, before AI, was highly paid, very few women. And so women tend to go for lower paying occupations. And it's not because of the patriarchy, because when women get more economic and political freedom, they tend to go even more for traditionally female-based occupations. And if you look at the top 20 female occupations from 100 years ago, it's pretty much what women in a free society are going into now. Women prefer dealing with people, and men prefer dealing with things. And dealing with things tends to be more economically productive than dealing with people, which tends to be hourly. Whereas if you deal with things and you manufacture stuff, you tend to get economies of scale, which you don't get for women. Men work longer hours. We have higher testosterone. We have generally more drive, and we can ignore our feelings in pursuit of an objective a little bit more than women. And of course, the other thing too is, well, you can get male and female economic equality for one generation and one generation only, and then there's no people left. Yay! Equality followed by the extinction event. And we've seen this a couple of times before, right? Because the only way that you can get men and women, outside of just ordering women to do economically productive things and maybe hitting them with massive doses of testosterone, is to give up on childbirth. Because childbirth and raising children, I mean, not only did I work at a daycare, but my daughter's almost 16. I've been a stay-at-home dad for 16 years. And that's just one kid, and she's great and easy to get along with, and not a boy. So I get that's a little different too. So childbirth and raising kids takes you out of the workforce. I mean, if you want to raise kids well, you got to keep them out of government schools. You got to, you know, spend all your day with them. And so you just can't be out there working and, you know, building some feminist empire if you want to raise kids. So, you know, that's another factor too, that when women get pregnant and have kids, they have to take time off to give birth. We want the kids breastfed because that's the best for their health, particularly their immune system. It's also better for the mothers. I mean, the fetus leaves behind stem cells that help repair a damage and injury to the mother decades later. So it's better for everyone's health. And a lot of women don't go back to the workforce because they want to stay home or they prefer staying home. And so we can get, I guess, men and women to parity, but only if we stop having kids. And, you know, I mean, I guess I'm somewhat of a fan of equality of opportunity, equality of outcome leading to the end of the human race so that one set of women gets to taste pure economic equality and then there's no more people. You know, seems like a bit of a high price to pay.
Next propaganda analysis. Men commit a disproportionate amount of crime because the patriarchy has entitled them to take whatever they want. Blacks commit a disproportionate amount of crime because institutionalized racism has forced them into poverty and forced them to commit crimes. What, if anything, is wrong with that statement?
Right. Well, I mean, I do think that men commit a disproportionate amount of crimes that are violent and obvious out there in society. But the big question is, if you include things like abortion as a crime, if you include abuse against children as a crime. And now, it's not just physical abuse. I mean, maybe this is slightly contentious to your audience, and I fully accept that, and slightly contentious to myself, if that helps at all. But verbal abuse against children is a violation of the non-aggression principle. In other words, if you keep telling a child you're stupid and selfish and an a-hole and a jerk, and you just keep putting them down, well, verbal abuse against adults is not a violation of the non-aggression principle because you're talking to an already formed personality that's perfectly free to leave. But if you were to kidnap someone and brainwash them, the brainwashing would be part, like you kept them up, you know, for 3 days straight and bombarded them with propaganda and so on. Well, that would not be violent abuse except for the confinement, but children are confined by the state of nature, by the fact that they're children. So verbal abuse against children is a violation of the non-aggression principle. So if you include spanking, if you include other forms of coercive discipline, such as confining to the room or even timeouts or using physical size and strength to confine children, if you include verbal abuse, then women commit more aggression than men. I mean, certainly in domestic violence cases, it's 50-50, even with the bias against men reporting against women. But if you include abortion and child abuse, women outstrip men with regards to violence by far. Like, it's not even close. It's not even close. The vast majority of men will go through their life without committing a violent crime. But the significant majority of women will commit a violent crime against their children. And it's only by ignoring children that we can pretend that men are just more abusive. If you look at coercive transfers of resources, well, women pay about half into the state that they get in benefits, So that's a coercive redistribution of resources from men to women. Men pay about half into the state as they get out in terms of benefits. And so that's another. If you look at some of the family court systems and issues where women coercively transfer resources through the power of politics from men to women, the aforementioned student loan crisis where women are forcing largely men to pay. If you look at the fact that like 90 to 95% of the infrastructure maintenance is men, which is a far more dangerous occupation than taking complaints about racism in an HR department, nice and air-conditioned, slightly more. I mean, I've done difficult and dangerous physical labor over the course of my youth, and there weren't any women out there at all, right? So letting men are like, what, 95% of workplace deaths are men and so on, right? So letting men take on all of that burden is not particularly great as well. So, and of course, the other thing too is that when men talk about this kind of stuff, they just get attacked and laughed down and aggressed against and so on. So I think in particular, modern society has tempted women into a fair amount of aggression and corruption under the guise of, once you can teach people to be resentful, the use of violence then becomes legitimate. With regards to blacks and violent crime, I would sort of refer you to the IQ interviews that I have done. It is common throughout black communities across the world, tragically. Blacks have a very high incidence of child abuse. I actually was talking to a black woman about this on a show recently, and she actually was so preyed upon by the black men in her community when she was a girl and a teenager that she actually starved herself, became anorexic in order to become less attractive. And according to the reports that I've read and interviews that I've perused, half of black women report being raped by black men before the age of 18. Now, saying that white people or other people are all responsible for that is bizarre to the point where I don't even know what to say, right? Because you can say people have agency, right? So blaming everyone else is not great. So, fixing the black family experience, fixing the three quarters of black children who are born raised without a father around or without married parents would do a lot. And that used to be way better. Back in the days of Jim Crow and genuine segregated racism, institutionalized racism, government program called racism, blacks were married at a rate of 80%. And blacks were getting out of the poor and into the middle class at very, very high rates. And then the government comes along to help, which is to create a dependent underclass. And of course, I think there's some fairly sinister people involved in pushing rap and nihilism and so on the black community and so on. So it's not just white racism. And with regards to the pay gap, it's a fairly traditional argument, but if women are just as productive as men, but you can get them for 77 cents on the dollar, then just build an entire corporation of women and you'll completely win in the marketplace. So all women need to do is just hire other women and they'll be fine. But and the last thing that I would sort of say, just in terms of credibility, is that I really don't generally take much advice from people on economics who've never created a single job. I've interviewed 1,000 people over the course of my career. I've hired over 100 people and negotiated raises for people who work for me. And so I've actually gone out and created jobs and had to work with young, old, male, female, all races and so on. And for the people who are complaining, I would just be like, okay, well, how many women have you hired? How many jobs have you created? And, not counting a government grant and I hired some people in a nonprofit, like actually in the free market, right? And if they haven't, it's like, it's cute. It's nice. It's like telling, when my daughter was little, she would talk about the restaurant she wanted to make. I actually incorporated this into one of my novels. Wouldn't it be great to have a restaurant in a tree with birds flying around and so on? And it's like dinosaurs. And yes, it would be. I completely agree with you. And it's a sort of fun fantasy to talk about. And so, but you wouldn't go build that restaurant. When I got older, I'd say, yeah, but the birds would poop on the food. Right? I mean, we have ducks. I know what that's all about. So for most people, when they're talking about this stuff, it's a childhood regression stuff. They don't have any actual experience creating jobs and managing people. And they have no skin in the game. And it's all just theoretical. They've never actually done it. Honestly, it's like my daughter talking about her fantasy restaurant. It's fun and it's cute, but it nothing to do with reality.
Next, the free market is inefficient and exploitative. We need to focus on people, not profit.
Inefficient. Well, I mean, it is inefficient for thieves. It is inefficient for people who want something for nothing. So I get that. You know, it is more efficient for people to steal a factory than to build a factory. So I get that it's inefficient for corrupt people who want something for nothing. But, you know, again, to me, this is all just incomplete childhood stuff because it's not reachable by reason. So when you're a baby and a toddler, people should be providing you resources. You should not have to provide any value or earn anything, right? I mean, nobody says to an 18-month-year-old baby, well, you can have your lunch, but first you have to mow the lawn or you have to wash the dishes or like there's no... So this idea that there are these benevolent entities that just give you stuff and you don't have to provide value, that's how we all start out in life. And it's our first couple of years. You know, arguably, you could say up until the age of, you know, 5 or 6. So our first half decade, and, you know, first impressions count for quite a lot in life. For our first half decade, we do live in a socialist paradise. Like, why is it that the old Marxist statement, from each according to their ability to each according to their needs? Why is it that that resonates so much with people? Because that's our childhood. From each according to their ability is the parents hunt and grow food. To each according to their need is the babies need resources, the toddlers need resources that they cannot earn themselves and should not try. I mean, you don't take a 2-year-old hunting and give him a bow and arrow because he's going to shoot himself or you in the leg, right? So I just look back to people, and this is why I talk to people about their childhoods, because until you can resolve childhood trauma, you can't really reason. Your brain is too scarred and avoidant and tense and stressed, and you're in PTSD and so on, right? I mean, it's like trying to give someone a complex mathematical proof while they're running from a bear. Like, they just can't concentrate on it. They can't think on it at all. They're just, shut up, I'm running from the bear. Like, there's just this panic and stress and so on, right? So as far as efficiency goes, I mean, I don't particularly care about efficiency. I care about virtue. And virtue is not very efficient at times, right? I mean, so I focus more on virtue than efficiency. But, well, for sure, the free market is efficient. And we touched on this last conversation. The people best able to maximize resources end up with most of the resources. The people who can put the best use of capital to increasing wealth tend to have the most capital. People want to invest in them and lend them money and so on. So efficiency is important. Exploitive? Well, that's one of these subjective things. You know, I mean, I guess everybody would like to be paid $1 million an hour, I suppose, and everybody would like to have all the hot men and women in the universe throw themselves at their feet. And, you know, what does it mean if that doesn't happen, right? The idea that there is an abstract value that exists outside of what you can negotiate is completely bizarre to me. Like, what am I worth? I'm worth what I can get people to pay me. I mean, there's no, yes, but in my mind's eye, you know, I should be a movie star and the lead singer of the Rolling Stones. And like, well, I guess if I can get the Rolling Stones to put me up front as a lead singer because they want to commit career suicide, I guess, you know, then I could be very, very briefly the lead singer for the Rolling Stones. Maybe I could do that opening part if you can't always get what you want with the alto children's choir. But you get what you negotiate. That's all. You know, I don't have a right to your time. I don't have a right to be on your show. You don't have a right, but we talk about it, we negotiate, and here we are. So it's called entitlement. It's a psychological, huge psychological problem. Entitlement is the belief that you are worth what you estimate yourself to be worth rather than what other people accept you to be worth. Right. So, you know, like the obese women who say men should find me sexy, it's like, no, that's not your call. That's not your call at all. Right. I mean, it's what you can negotiate. When I was in the free market, I'm still in the free market, but when I was a corporate executive in the software field, yeah, we would try to get investment. We would try to get people to buy our product. We would hire people. And it was all about what we could negotiate. I mean, I wanted to sell my software for $10 million a pop, but I could only get $1 million. Do I say, I've been ripped off for $9 million? It's like, no, the $10 million is a fantasy. What you think you're worth is a fantasy. Everybody's the main star in their own production, and we should be. But I, you know, how many eyeballs do I deserve? As many as I earn. How many donations am I worth? As many as I can earn. And this idea that there's this abstract value that you have that exists only in your own mind and people are ripping you off if they don't take it. Well, that's what rapists think. I'm not calling everyone who believes this a rapist, but the rapist is like, I deserve sex. No, you don't at all, right? You deserve what you, if you can get a woman to have sex with you voluntarily, fantastic. If you can't, leave them alone. So this idea that capitalism is exploitive and it underpays people and it's like, you are what you negotiate. You're worth what you negotiate. Now, as a kid, that's a different matter, right? You don't negotiate as a kid. You're just given resources. So again, it's all of this incomplete childhood stuff and this resentment. And I should get more than I am contributing, which is exploitive, right? I mean, if you can contribute $1 million to a business, you can ask for some portion of that in salary. But if you only give $50 worth of value to a business, you can't really ask for anything because they, right? So you have to provide value and you have to negotiate for it. And other people have to agree voluntarily with your assessment of your value. And you generally will meet somewhere in the middle, right? You want more, they want to pay you less. You meet somewhere in the middle and that's all you're worth. And this is why this is not anything specific to me. This is sort of a Miesian argument that there's no such thing as objective value. Value is always subjective. So when people say, I'm exploited and I'm underpaid and women should get paid more and these people should be paid this and these people, it's like there's this abstract standard of fairness that exists independent of what people can negotiate, and there just isn't. It's just a fantasy and it's just a complaining bludgeon to try and get resources by nagging.
Two of the biggest propaganda, I guess you could say, operations that I have come across in my life are, one, the COVID narrative. Turns out that there was no correlation between states that had severe lockdown policies and mask mandates with states that had either no policy or those policies to a much lesser degree. So that COVID narrative was complete propaganda. Second is the food pyramid. In class, this would be elementary school in Arizona. You always had the Constitution on the wall, the American flag on the wall, the presidents on the wall, and the food pyramid, which said the primary thing that your diet should be surrounded on is bread, pasta, and grains. Of course, since this has been embraced, American obesity rates have skyrocketed. Check out the carnivore diet. Help me lose 110 pounds. So the question is, it's not that. Well, maybe the majorities are all wrong, but we don't have to worry about the majority. They're ignorant. The experts, the majority of the experts in these fields, at least the ones that we loudly heard from, were wrong on these issues primarily. How is it that so many experts could be so blatantly wrong about something?
Yeah, I mean, I think in the future, they'll look back in our time and say all the gravestones should have been pyramid shaped because that's what's killing most people. It's absolutely appalling. And I mean, there's a lot of politics involved, as you know, in the food pyramid. I mean, there were a bunch of heart attacks in the 50s and in among people in political power, and they kind of freaked out and they said, oh, it's, you know, the fats that are the problem. And so they started stripping fat out of food, but then it tasted like cardboard. So they started adding sugar. And of course, women went to the workforce, which meant that you couldn't make meals from scratch. So processed food became more valid. And, you know, if you ever had one of those pizzas, maybe before your carnivore thing, you know, those frozen pizzas that come on the cardboard, it's like, you might as well just leave the cardboard on. It tastes about the same. I mean, just a little bit extra roughage. So yeah, food has become significantly poisoned in the modern realm. Of course, the sugar industry paid some scientists to say sugar is not the culprit and so on. So it's all completely corrupt. And of course, most of it has to just to do with government money and bad incentives. I mean, the whole COVID situation was a fiat currency situation. It was a debt and government money situation. COVID had nothing to do with medicine or health as far as that goes. Because if you were to go to people and you were to say, like, how much money did they spend developing the COVID vaccines or the mRNA technology over the past, you know, it's been 20 years or whatever, right? Well, it's hundreds of billions of dollars or I don't know, whatever it was, right? So if you were to go to people and you were to say, okay, there's this virus that's around, even if we kind of ignore the bioweapons lab origins of it, which to me is an open and shut case. And I made this case years and years ago called the case against China. So even if we were to just say, oh, it did come from bats. It did come from a pangolin or whatever it is. So we've got this virus. Here's the problem. And the cure is going to cost you $150,000, or the shot, right? The vaccine is going to cost you $150,000, which, you know, per person with all the debt and, you know, and so on, because not many people would pay that amount of money, right? They'd say, okay, are there any other alternative treatments, right? Now, of course, as you know, they had to suppress alternative treatments to get the emergency use authorization. But they'd say, is there anything cheaper? Well, there's this ivermectin that won a Nobel Prize, and it's really only pennies a dose, and blah, blah, blah. They'd look for alternatives, right? So how is it that they gave away this incredibly complicated and expensive technology for free? It was government money, government spending. So, and what was the incentive to suppress alternative treatments or natural immunity or all the other things, right? Well, the incentive was that you didn't get access to hundreds of billions of dollars of, quote, free government money if there were alternative treatments. And of course, as we all know, the absolute horror shows that went on inside hospitals, where hospitals were paid tens of thousands of dollars per COVID patient and COVID death, where patients, hospitals were even further incentivized in some places to put people on ventilators and so on, with the idea of overcoming the cost, but it does create the ultimate perverse incentive, which is hospitals were, in many cases, paid for bad outcomes. And we all know that people respond to incentives. Of course, there were a lot of honorable and decent doctors who did the right thing. We also know, of course, that doctors were massively incentivized to have people take the vaccines, like not just all vaccines, but in particular the mRNA vaccine, to the tune of tens or sometimes even hundreds of thousands of dollars. Well, where's that money coming from? It's coming from the government. So the funding for these labs came from the government, which is, of course, where I'm fairly certain that the virus came from. So the money that came from it, these things only exist because of the government, and the money for the medicines or the COVID shots came from the government, and then the government handed blanket immunity to the manufacturers, and then the government, at least until they were sued for the documents, allowed for the some pharmaceutical companies to hide the data for 75 years. And that to me was like, come on. I mean, I hate to say IQ test, but you know, it's novel technology. They're not releasing the source data. And the manufacturers are demanding immunity. And they're saying they know that it's safe and effective with no long-term data. I mean, that to me, I don't even know what to say. Like, I genuinely am baffled as to why people fell for this stuff so hard, but obviously they did. But then they also got, hey, you can feel like a really good person by obeying those in charge and hating your fellow citizen. And sadly, that is just a thing that human beings are very susceptible to. We're going to give you a gold sticker for obeying those in charge, and you get the moral joy of hating your fellow citizens who are not conforming. And sadly, that's just over and over. That's a copy paste in history, which goes back to early childhood stuff, I think. But so the experts, I mean, people respond to incentives, and people who are not, you know, my moral tradition, of course, is Christianity. And so a lot of scientists are anti-theistic, right? And we'll just talk about Christianity, sort of the foundation of Western morals, the combo of Socrates and Jesus. So why would people tell the truth when they're punished for it and they're rewarded for lying? Well, the only reason you would tell the truth when you're punished for telling the truth and rewarded for lying is you have an abstract moral principle that surmounts the hedonism of immediate material incentives. I mean, Jesus was offered the entire world under his dominion if he just worshiped Satan, and he's like, nope, not going to do it, right? So in the absence of Christianity, or in the absence of universal moral objective values and rules, people just respond to base mammal material immediate incentives. Oh, I get approval, dopamine. Oh, I get money, dopamine. Oh, I'm going to have disapproval and punishments for not doing what people say. Well, when you take away people's abstract morals, they just become basically frightened lemmings that are running from the dinosaurs and running towards the food. They become like, you know, when you're out in nature and you're walking through this lovely forest, you come across this beautiful meadow And it's like, well, it's just full of animals trying to eat each other, not get eaten, and reproduce in often violent ways. It just becomes a hedonistic treadmill. And so the experts were responding to all of the incentives, and I assume, absent any overarching moral rules, well, they just pretend to be moral and lie and take benefits and avoid punishments. When you get people to abandon morality, they become very easy to control, which is why the powers that be have a great hostility these days for Christianity and moral philosophers to some degree, because it's easy to control people without abstract moral values, because all you do is threaten them with punishment and bribe them with rewards. Oh, you get 90% of people to comply without moral rules. So I assume that they were experts in maximizing benefits and minimizing discomfort. So that's their expertise. And I take all of their statements through that filter.
Do you have time for two more, or should I push these for tomorrow?
Let's do one more, if that's all right.
Absolutely.
Oh, no. So no, wait. There's one other option. I could be concise. No, let's be real. Okay, you know what? I will try to be concise, because it's not your fault. My daughter has this yapping. She just says this yapping, right? Yap, yap, yap. When I disagree with her, yap, yap, yap. I get this little Pac-Man thing come through. So you know what? You had great questions. I have been fairly yappy. So, I'll take on the challenge. Let's do two and I'll be concise.
What criteria can we use to differentiate evil people from people who genuinely just have a different view of the world?
Right. Are they villains or are they victims? This is a big question in life. So people who succumb to propaganda, are they driving propaganda because propaganda lets them do bad things, like hate their fellow citizens for private medical decisions? Or are they victims in that they've been lied to and don't know about it? Well, there is a test, and we talked about this briefly, so I can talk about it even more briefly, which is people go from victimhood to villainy when they're given accurate information. Right? So when I talked to people about the COVID shots, I said, well, they can't possibly know the long-term effects because it's only been a couple of months. And they're not releasing the source data. And they want to hide the documents for 75 years, and they've demanded immunity from liability. Now, if people are like, yeah, you know what, that is interesting, I hadn't, you know, then that's fine. Then there are people who are looking for information, they don't have the information yet, and they are good actors who lack information, which is true for all of us. We all lack information about, I know nothing about virtually anything, because, you know, the sum total of human knowledge is virtually infinite, and what I have is a tiny spot or slice of that. Hopefully the principles are overarching, but so for me, it's like when somebody lacks information, they are in a morally neutral place. But when you give them that information and they react with hostility, then they're revealed not as victims of a lack of information, which we all are to a large degree, but they're revealed as villains. And if they, you know, there's this eerie, stunning silence in Canada at the moment about the vaccines and what happened, and the stripping of rights and travel and income and so on, right? And so if people were like, wow, you know, I fell for this stuff, and you know, there was some stuff that was kind of doubtful about it and so on, right? But if they don't talk about it afterwards, and they don't circle back and reflect and say, okay, well, what happened there? Was I a good guy? Was I a bad guy? At least have a conversation about it, right? Because certainly what people were told at the beginning is not what has played out. And so people who don't circle back and people who resist the topic, people who resist knowledge or in the possession of knowledge still believe things that are false and wrong, that to me is when they go from victim to villain.
The Iron Law of Oligarchy states, all complex organizations, regardless of how democratic they are when started, eventually develop into oligarchies, since no sufficiently large and complex organization can function purely as a direct democracy. Power within an organization will always get delegated to individuals within that group, elected or otherwise. Does the existence of the Iron Law of Oligarchy basically refute all of leftism, that all of us can be equally participants in society?
So, you know this old meme in Minecraft? I don't know if you know this old meme, where you say something that could get you in trouble with the authorities, and then you say, in Minecraft, right? And there's this meme You know, like, we should do X, Y, and Z terrible thing in Minecraft, right? And it's the meme of the FBI agent ripping off his, oh, come on, he said in Minecraft, right? And so to me, like, all of these rules and these laws, it's like in statism. You know, it's like if somebody's like, oh, I'm an expert biologist, I study all these animals, and then you look and I study all these animals and learn their nature and their properties and what they do and what they don't do and what they like and don't like and their habits. And then he never mentions to you that he only ever studies animals in a zoo. It's like, that's not animals in their natural state. That's animals in a zoo. And so the iron law of oligarchy is like, that's in statism. Things get more and more complex and you have less and less impact and things get in statism. So it is certainly true that organizations get bigger and bigger and more complex and then become unwieldy. And then, in a free market, they collapse into their constituent elements and the whole process starts again. In statism, you can prop these companies up with preferential laws, hiring policies, government grants, loans, protection from foreign competition, tariffs, you name it, right? So, I mean, everybody knows in Japan for like the last 40 years, there have been these zombie corporations that are kept alive through government spending, right? I mean, they have what, the highest per capita national debt in the world, right? And so in statism, yes, oh gosh, you know, things get really complicated and corrupt and bad and wrong and this and that and the other. It's like, yes, in statism. But that's like looking at animals in a zoo and think you understand something about the nature of animals. Human beings are in a human zoo. We are in tax livestock farms called countries. And we are constantly prodded and pushed and bullied and threatened and coerced and lied to. And we are in a state of anxiety and existential coercion and sometimes direct coercion, right? So whatever we look at when we are looking at human nature or we are looking at social organization or we are looking at corporations, corporations are legal fictions invented by the state so that rich people can pillage organizations for all the profits while accruing none of the liabilities, right? Because the corporation takes the liability, right? So if you are a bad guy and a corporation does some bad things, the corporation gets sued, you get to keep usually all the money. Occasionally, if there's criminal things, that wouldn't be the case. But the corporation is a big magical shield wherein you say, oh, no, it's my invisible friend who committed all the crimes, so you can just throw him in jail. Oh, my invisible friend has been dissolved, therefore there's no wrongdoing. I mean, corporations are horrible legal fictions invented to bribe the elites to be enslaved and dependent upon and therefore praising off political power as a whole. So whenever people say, well, human beings are like this, and there's this inevitable cycle of civilization, and there's this corruption, and these organizations are too big to, and the corruption and politics gets in, it's like, in statism, why is art so much crap? Because lying to people through art is incredibly profitable, because every election in most Western democracies is responsible for the transfer of hundreds of billions of dollars worth of resources, and people love political power. They're addicted to it, right? So when we say, well, you know, art inevitably becomes politicized, like, in statism, and corporations inevitably become corrupt, in statism, well, there's regulatory capture in that the people, the government agencies that are supposed to regulate these industries always end up being controlled by those industries, in statism. So yeah, there's all these national debts. In statism, you can't have a national debt without a statist society. So I, as long as people say in statism, right? I mean, it's sort of like saying, you know, all of the manual laborers are demotivated, and you're saying that in ancient Greece, right? It's like, well, yes, but it's slavery, right? So the problem with manual labor is that they're just unmotivated and they just, you have to keep prodding and pushing them and they don't want to work. And this is the problem of human nature. And it's like, no, it's a problem of slavery. Now, once you free the slaves, then you get some pretty hard workers who are kind of entrepreneurial sometimes and they don't resent as much and productivity goes up. You get labor-saving devices, all you get the modern world. So when slavery was foundational to all civilizations, as it was throughout all of human history until relatively recently, then you would say, well, I mean, of course, you have to whip your slaves. They have no motivation. They don't do anything unless you force them to. And it's like, in slavery. And so taking as axiomatic what organizations and human beings do in statism and saying that this is some sort of foundational existential thing, it's like, no, These are all just shadows cast by the system we choose to accept. And if we start to think of a different system, then we can have different outcomes. So I would not accept that as anything other than describing the actions of human beings trapped in a fairly hellish zoo, which we kind of are. And so when we start thinking outside the system, we don't have to look at these as iron laws, but simply the shadows cast by the coercion we accept in society.
Thank you to everyone for watching Keith and I Don't Tread on Anyone in the Libertarian Institute. Check out freedomain.com in the description below. Mr. Molyneux, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And thank you for access to your audience. We'll talk soon.